My name is Patrick Vernon. I'm a social commentator, culture store and campaigner, and also I've worked for many years in the voluntary and public sector around projects and programmes and organisations around tackling in health inequalities, particularly mental health, public health and race equality. I first got involved in campaigning probably when I was a student, actually, back in the good old days of the kind of 80s, when there was lots of activism taking place. There was the miners' strike, there was lots of deportation campaigns, there was campaigns around the anti-apartheid movement and freeing Nelson Mandela. And I kind of got involved and immersed in that when I was a student in Manchester. But my first proper campaign where I had a kind of really important role, lead role, was when a few years after I'd studied at university. I studied law, by the way, and there was a murder of a black guy in Wolverhampton, my hometown, Clinton McCurbin, in the late 1980s, and he died in the next clothes shop. And similar circumstances as George Floyd, and actually he was arrested by the police thinking they had stolen a credit card, and even up to this day there's no evidence of that. And as he was gasping for breath and before he died, when he was being held down by the police, he said, "I can't breathe." And that still lingers with me even today as well. And I've been in other, and since then that's influenced me to be in other campaigns over the last two, three decades, to be quite honest. The role of voice is really, really critical. I mean, if you look at the history of the voluntary sector and the rise of grassroots organisations, and in particular the voluntary sector councils have been established, it was about giving voice at a local level. Voices reflecting different issues affecting people around inequality and social justice. And those voices were eventually influenced development of services and programs and activities. And eventually those voices became almost like independent themselves in terms of advocacy and campaigning as well. So the voice is really critical, and also for social change. People have got different takes on what is social change. For how I see social change, particularly in the context of Black Lives Matter, the pandemic, and a whole range of other factors, it's made it very clear that social change in Britain in the 21st century, moving on to the 22nd century, is not about talking just about equality or equality of opportunity, or even moving on to the conversation we're having right now about equity. It's like working towards inclusion and liberation. That's the agenda, I believe, around social change. It means that we have to acknowledge structural racism. We have to recognise ongoing issues around sexism, homophobia, disablism, some of the issues around disability. So if you want to really have this inclusive Britain, a multicultural, multi-secular Britain, a country that feels confident about its own identity, and that they see the concept of Britishness reflecting Britain in all its shapes and sizes, not a narrow perception of Britishness, which often is reinforced by the media and by government, basically. What's the opportunity for the sector around voice? I think the sector has a key role. If the sector can't create the platforms and resources and the capacity for people from a whole range of communities to share their lived experiences of discrimination, equality, frustration, then it's failing its job. You almost become part of the problem. If you're more concerned about getting funding just to deliver service, but you're afraid of even engaging with the voices that you're meant to be representing, you're acting as a disservice. It's a challenge. It's a hard one, because we know that in terms of recent years, there's been a tightening in terms of charity law, about what you can say, what you can't say, which might be seen to impede government regulations around the use of your charitable objectives. But if you look at the creation of charities, particularly from its growth in the late Victorian period, with that magical expression, the relief of the poor, which is now much wider than that, as we know, it was always about voice then. And I think at times, and there have been a number of organisations who have taken on the government, taken legal action, judicial reviews, to demonstrate that voice is really important. So I feel that, yes, you may have your contracts to deliver services, but do not ever forget those voices were there in the first place. And it's those voices that that has enabled your organisation to get the funding to deliver those services. And it's important that those voices are front and centre in terms of your strategy, on your board, how you do things as an organisation. And that's probably some of the challenges that we face. You know, we know there's limited resources out there. We've, you know, over the last 10, 12 years, we've had the kind of austerity, which has now been further intensified around the impact of Brexit and also COVID-19. But you know what? You know, despite all these challenges, there are people out there that, you know, you still can be creative, you still can be bold, you still can do things, even with limited resources, because it's about people power. And that's where volunteering comes in. What was quite clear as a result of the pandemic, a lot of people decided to volunteer in their neighbourhoods, been involved in food banks, in terms of a whole range of community support as well. But also it raised issues that we need to make volunteering more inclusive. I mean, for example, NCVO and a whole range of organisations are working together as a third sector to develop a 10-year vision around volunteering. And, you know, the work I do, particularly at Centre for Aging Better, we want to make sure that volunteering is inclusive of age. So there's an age-friendly perspective from volunteering. So whatever age you are, you have the opportunity to volunteer or to act as citizens and be part of some kind of initiative locally that you feel that you're making a difference. And also all the research work that's been done is if you volunteer, give your time, it's also good for your well-being too, because you're adding something back to society, back to community. So volunteering is going to be even more critical. And, you know, and there's a whole range of people in society who could volunteer more, but we need to think of ways of breaking down the barriers and blockages to prevent them from volunteering and giving their time. And to almost like reframe the word, what volunteering means, because often volunteering often means formal volunteering, which is still important, but we need to look at informal volunteering, community participation, different ways of how people can get involved in their local communities or support local services as well. What's my final words to you at this conference in Hampshire? Hampshire is an interesting county. You've got a lot of rich history there. And I think my advice to you is don't forget voice, be brave, work in partnership, work strategically. And people use the word co-production all the time, but I think we're in the age of co-production, co-creation, and don't feel that you have to work, you can do everything as an organisation in your own right. Work together, collectively, so the voices can rise and the voices can feel validated and the voices can be used to develop new services and new ways of influencing what happens in the county in terms of funding, the role of local government, the NHS and the private sector, a whole range of different stakeholders. I hope you enjoy the conference and support the work of Hampshire VCS and particularly all the stakeholders in Hampshire. Thank you.